All right, welcome to session six. Just a few more sessions after this, but so now we are with Jesus. The account of Jesus going into the garden, the arrest, and all this. Remember, this is being told from John's perspective, the Apostle John. And he was with Jesus throughout all of this. So we're getting, obviously, the Holy Spirit revealing a lot of this information, but definitely firsthand information from the Apostle John. So the first section here, I titled Journey to the Cross Before the Authorities. This is what our lesson covers today. So he's arrested in the garden. Got a map up here if you can see it. If not, you should have sat closer. Just for my point of reference, this is a map of Jerusalem. Here's the city wall. Here's the temple, which is the center, of course, or the most important part. It's higher elevated. Then you have the Kidron Valley. John tells us, then Jesus and his disciples travel through the Kidron Valley to the Mount of Olives, to a little garden there. Okay, and so this is the Kidron Valley here. This little, and your lesson, your study guide talked about this, I believe. It's a deep valley, and you have to go down from this temple area, probably through these gates, down, and then you got to kind of go right back up into this mountain, or the Mount of Olives, and then in that olive orchard is where the garden was. So here's the Kidron Valley here. This is an interesting map. It's just a guess, obviously, because it was things have changed a lot in Jerusalem. But here you have traditional sites. Here you would have the high priest, Caiaphas's house. And then here you have Herod's fortress. When King Herod was in town, remember King Herod's up in Galilee, when King Herod was in town, this is where he would stay, and maybe Pontius Pilate would stay there too, I'm not sure. So that's important to remember in the Gospels, the other Gospels, where Pilate sends Jesus to Herod, he's not sending them all the way back up a couple days' journey up to Galilee. He's just sending them across town. Herod's already, because it's a Passover, so Herod's in town. So Jesus is brought here to this Herod's fortress. Here's the Praetorium, which is where the barracks for the some of the Roman soldiers are kept. And this is where Pilate had kind of his judgment seat when he put Jesus on trial, was in the Praetorium. And then over here is this Antonia Fortress. I think I read somewhere around 600, 700 soldiers were kept there, especially during the Passover, in case there was an outbreak, a riot of some sort. So they were all barracked up in here. So this is just, for me, helpful. Has anybody been to Israel in this class? So I could tell you anything about it, you'd believe me, right? This morning, Carol Grimm has been over there, so she verified everything I've said. But these are just some pictures of the orchard, the olive grove orchard. These are current pictures. I just took them the other day. No, these are current pictures. Carol said that when she went over to Israel, she got the chance to go to the Garden of Gethsemane, Mount of Olives, and this is exactly what it looks like. So you have these kind of tall, crooked trees or orchard vines and stuff. You can imagine at night what that looks like. It would be very dark and scary, which is interesting because when the Apostle John talks about the group of people coming to arrest Jesus, John's the only one who tells us that they brought torches, they brought lanterns. And that just seems like, well, of course they would. But think about going into this dark valley of the Kidron at nighttime, and then up into the Mount of Olives, and then searching in the garden area, in the olive grove, searching for the Garden of Gethsemane, and how important it would be to have torches and to have lights. Those torches were not like you see in the movies where they go off to arrest somebody with pitchfork and torches. That's not what the torches were meant for. It's just these are basically to light their way to the dark garden. Alright. So we're told, John tells us this was a frequent meeting spot for Jesus and his disciples, wherever this garden was. Remember, this is a big orchard, and there's lots of little sitting spots and gardens, and this idea was a Garden of Gethsemane, which means olive press. that is probably known to some, but this is a frequent place for Jesus and his disciples to hang out. So, of course, it was familiar to Judas, but maybe not to many others. That's why they couldn't just say to the people coming to arrest Jesus, oh yeah, just go to that garden, you'll find him. No, Judas had to lead. He had to show them the way to where Jesus would often meet. So they come to arrest Jesus. That's where John goes with this. They come to arrest Jesus. But what's missing here, an important part of the Passion story, what's missing here that's in the other three Gospels? That's missing too, but before that. No, you're all right. It's not what I'm looking for, though.
Praying with Jesus?
Yes, the garden of the actual Garden of Gethsemane with Jesus praying and, you know, telling his disciples, wait over here, I'm going to go over to pray. He takes Peter, James, and John, and they fall asleep, and he comes back three times, and they're still, you know, that, you know, familiar with that story. And he prays, not my will, but thy will be done, and his sweat drops like blood, Luke tells us. A very important part of the gospel story, and John doesn't record it. Even though he was an eyewitness to it, he doesn't record it. And the reason was, it had already been recorded. You know, people already knew this. So John, once again, is trying to add more information here to the gospel account that people didn't already know. Matthew, Mark, and Luke have already done a pretty good job of talking about the Garden of Gethsemane. So here, John has a different purpose. So who comes to arrest Jesus? Matthew tells us a large crowd armed with swords and clubs sent from the chief priests and the elders of the people. Mark tells us a crowd armed with swords and clubs sent from the chief priests. He adds the teachers of the law and the elders. When you put chief priests, teachers of the law, and elders, you've got pretty much the main body, ruling body of the religious leaders here. Luke tells us Jesus and his Jesus has his conversation. Jesus said to the chief priests, the officers of the temple guard, and the elders who had come for him. So Luke tells us that it wasn't just people sent by the chief priests, it was some of the chief priests themselves. Some of the Sanhedrin, the ruling body, came out, and they brought the temple guard. These were paid, trained soldiers, not Roman soldiers, Jewish soldiers, who guarded the temple. That's why they're called the temple guard. But he brings them as well. So you kind of get this idea. Well, John tells us a detachment or a band of soldiers and some officials from the chief priests and Pharisees carrying torches, lanterns, and weapons. So this is, in fact, Roman soldiers. Some Roman soldiers were brought along. We don't think, as I was looking through some of the different writings and history books and commentaries and things, it doesn't seem like many people assume it was that Pontius Pilate sent those soldiers. It seems more like the chief priest probably knew they needed the backup just in case. And so maybe stopped by the fortress of Antonia, or whatever that is called, grabs a few, says, hey, come with us in case there's an uprising or something like that. So I don't know if this was an official Pontius Pilate sending soldiers into the garden, more so just soldiers listening to the religious leaders. So they come into the garden, and who was leading them, this band, this crowd?
Judas.
All four Gospels tell us that. Judas is leading. Which is just, we get the irony of that. You know, that he's leading them through the darkness with the torches and the clanging of armor and the swords and the clubs, and he's actually leading them. Mark is the one who tells us that Judas had arranged a kiss. Judas tells the chief priest, the man I kiss, that'll be the one you should arrest. That's actually what Judas says. The man I kiss, arrest him. Well, that sounds real friendly, doesn't it? So Mark's the one who tells us that Judas was the one who set this in motion. Then Matthew and Luke tell us that he actually kisses Jesus, and Jesus' response, which is what?
You betray the Son of Man with a kiss.
Yeah, you betray me with a kiss. The Son of Man is betrayed with a kiss. John doesn't record that whole episode necessarily. All right, so rested in the garden. Jesus came toward them and asked, whom do you seek? This is pretty striking. Don't just pass over it. This is a mob, a large crowd of people. Romans, Jewish people, Jewish leaders, clubs and swords, coming to arrest Jesus. And what does Jesus do? He goes out to meet them. That's not what you would expect. You would expect him to do what? Flee. But this is dramatic. John's telling us how dramatic this was. Jesus is not running away from this. In fact, he meets them. He goes out of the garden to meet them. That's very important. And he asks them, "Who do you seek?" They respond, "Jesus of Nazareth." And he gives them an answer to that, a response to that. And what do they do after that? When Jesus answers them. They react by, this is a painting if you can see it. He says what he has to say, and they go, oh, and they fall on the ground, on their knees. They fall backwards. And as you, in your questions, you were answering that a little bit. The power, it probably was amazing to them. Here they come with the full authority of the religious leaders. And Jesus meets them, first of all. And then they say, the power. This is not somebody who's afraid of them. But the real reason, more than likely, that they fell backwards is why? What did he say to them? He says, "I am he." You're more familiar with it as "ego we me." He says, "ego we me." Most of this crowd that came to arrest Jesus was Jewish. And when you hear someone say, "ego and me," their first thought should have been blasphemy. So then why do they fall backwards? Because perhaps for just a split second, the man who is powerful enough to come to meet them says this word with power. Not timidly, but for just a split second in their hearts, they realize they're standing in the presence of God. That's why they fell backwards and why they fell to their knees. For just a split second. Now this, of course, is important to John, isn't it? "Ego and me" is a familiar refrain in John's gospel. The "I am" statements. "Ego and me," the Lamb of God. Or "ego and me," the bread of life. "Ego and me," the light of the world. So this is the final, as John structured his gospel, this is the final "ego and me," and it's the most dramatic. Then he's brought to Annas first. So they arrest him, and they bring him to Annas. A little background on Annas here. Only mentioned in John's gospel. I think that's important. And I'll tell you why in just a second. Only John mentions Annas. Annas was appointed as high priest in the year 6 AD under Roman governor of that region, Quirinius. Does that sound familiar? Why does that name Quirinius sound familiar to all of you? Christmas story. What about the Christmas story? The census. In the year when Quirinius was governor of Syria, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that the entire Roman world should be taxed. And then Linus comes out with his blanket, tells the story. Okay. Quirinius, he's governor of Syria, and in those days, Syria kind of enveloped Palestine and Israel. Same Quirinius. Quirinius, the governor, appoints the high priest in 6 AD, Annas. He's removed from office in 15 AD by Governor Valerius Gratus, who was the one who preceded Pontius Pilate. So as you know, they appointed governors, prefects, over the southern region in Judah to rule the people. And so you had Governor Gratus, who doesn't like High Priest Annas, removes him from office, had the power to do that, removes him from office. And in your notes, in your homework, it said, basically, once a high priest, always a high priest. Roman government might have removed him from office, but the people and the religious leaders still saw him as high priest. He's a very powerful person, even though he's not in that position by the Romans. In fact, he's so powerful, five of his sons and his son-in-law, Caiaphas, all served as high priest at some point. This is a pretty important dude, pretty important guy. And so it's interesting that John tells us that the first thing they do after they arrest Jesus is they take him to see Annas first. before they go to his son-in-law Caiaphas. Out of respect, I would guess. And we'll also see in this gospel that the first recorded physical attack on Jesus occurs at Annas' house. We know there's going to be a lot more coming up. But so what was the first attack?
Slapped.
He was slapped or punched or whatever because he had answered the high priest, and one of the servants struck him. Is this how you answer the high priest? And Jesus said, what did I say that was wrong? This has begun the first of many blows that Jesus would suffer. So then they take him to to Caiaphas. Caiaphas served from 18 A.D. to 36 A.D. 18 years is pretty long for a high priest. The high priest and the governor of that area had to get along. There was a tenuous relationship. It was very political in nature. But there was this give and take. Quid pro quo. I messed that up this morning. I did a pretty good there. There's kind of a give and take between the governor and the high priest. They both wielded extreme power. So here you have Caiaphas serves, and when Pilate becomes a governor in 26. Normally what happened was when a governor would take office, the first thing he would do is find another high priest. Find somebody you can get along with, somebody you can work with, start fresh. That was a normal procedure. But here Pilate seems to get along with Caiaphas pretty good, so keeps him on while he's ruling. The mock trial, which was conducted in Caiaphas' court, is omitted by the Apostle John in his gospel once again, because it's been written about. Matthew, Mark, and Luke tell about it all the time. You know, the pretty extensively what happens about being in Caiaphas' house and the false statements and the accusations and all this stuff. John's not interested in recounting that. He knows our readers already know that. And just a side note here before we continue before we have a tale of two Simon Peters in this section. You have the upper room Peter, who says to Jesus, even if all fall away on account of you, I never will. If I have to die with you, I will never disown you. Upper room Peter. That's from Matthew and Luke, Matthew and Mark. In Luke, Peter says, Lord, I'm ready to go with you to prison and to death. So Peter has in mind that something's going to happen to Jesus soon. He's going to get arrested, put to death, and Peter says, I'm right there with you. Look over your shoulder. I'm right behind you. I'm ready to go to prison if that's what we're going to happen, even to the gallows or even to death if I have to. And in John's gospel, Peter says, Lord, I will lay down my life for you. Upper room, Peter. What about Garden of Gethsemane, Peter? Well, wax off the servant's ear. Sounds like upper room Peter, right? Now, here's something to think about. Jesus had just said, ego me. And the group of people did what? And immediately, it seems like in John's gospel, here comes Peter with the sword. That's not a very good sound for a sword. Whack! I don't know what the sword is, how an ear sounds when it's getting cut off. But think about this. Peter feels empowered by Jesus. Jesus is powerful, and the people that came to arrest him are falling over. And Peter sees this as an opportunity. Let's seize the kingdom of God. Remember, these disciples and most of the people thought Jesus had come to kill them, to get rid of the Romans and establish kingdom. And now, here's Jesus, ego me, with all that authority. And what does Jesus say to Peter after that? Put the thing away before you get somebody killed. He says, put that away. Don't you think I could call down legions and legions of angels? And that's a turning point for Peter. That Gethsemane Peter whacking off ears when Jesus says, enough. In other words, that's not why I came. That changes things for Peter. And so then we see courtyard Peter. And we'll talk about the courtyard in just a minute here. What does courtyard Peter look like? I don't even know the man. Three times he says that. We're talking just a matter of hours here. Jesus didn't meet his expectations. And Jesus has been arrested. Jesus is in the Caiaphas' court, and they're beating him, and all this stuff going on. He's going, you know, they know, Peter knows the writing's on the wall. Jesus is going to die. He doesn't want to be associated with him all of a sudden. I will lay down my life for you. He forgot about that. Now he's just trying to save his own skin. And so three times he says, I don't even know the man. So let me tie some thoughts together here. The Garden of Gethsemane, Peter, what was the name of the man whose ear Peter cut off? How do you know that? It said so in the Bible. Who wrote that? Jesus. Okay, no, that's John. This is the, okay, what book of the Bible are we studying?
John.
Okay, I just want to make sure we're on the same page. John tells us that the name of the person whose ear was cut off is Malchus, and also tells us what he does for a living. Did you catch that? Yeah, he's the servant of the high priest. John gives us that information in his gospel. That's only in John's gospel. I mean, the sword cutting off ear stuff is in the Gospels, but only the name of Malchus is given here by John. Now, go back to the courtyard. How did Peter even get into the courtyard of the high priest? How did John get him in? You said John, you're right. How did John get him in? He knew who? He knew the high priest. So the lady who's guarding the gate, whatever, just kind of lets John in. She recognizes John. Which would mean what? John's been there before. John's got a connection to the high priest. Now it says here, another disciple was known to the high priest. But this is John's way of not referring to himself. If this was like Bartholomew, John would have said that. But he wants to remain anonymous in his own gospel. So this is... It's pretty incredible. John is known to the high priest. So familiar enough that the person guarding the courtyard lets him in and lets him bring his friends in, or friend in this case. Some have speculated that maybe John's family was related to the family of the high priest. That makes the plot thicker. That thickens the plot. All right. What was significant about the third person who accused Peter of being a disciple of Jesus? Do you remember reading that? Yeah. Yeah. He was a relative of Malchus and had seen what Peter had done in the garden. This person, warming himself by the fire with Peter, had been in the garden when all that took place and was a relative of Malchus. So he's got some skin in the game here. His relative Malchus has lost an ear. Right? And probably saw Jesus heal that ear, okay? And so this guy comes up to Peter and says, hey, I saw you out. I don't know the man. How absurd that would be for Peter to think that. But here's the question I have is, who would know this? Who would know that this person who talked to Peter was the relative of Malchus?
John.
Yeah, more than likely John. This is, to me, it's just fascinating. How John is connected to the high priest, to Malchus and his relatives somehow. And this might explain why John has been allowed in the high priest's courtyard. And where does John find himself when Jesus is crucified? At the foot of the cross. You think the religious leaders are going to allow the disciples to kneel at the foot of the cross? I wouldn't think so, but there's John. So somebody called him some favors on this one. I think there's a strong connection between John and the high priest here. Not that it really matters, but it helps kind of explain the story a little bit. And that's why John kind of includes this. He's brought before Pontius Pilate. Pilate was appointed as prefect or governor of Judah in 26 AD. When did Jesus die? 33. During the reign of Roman Emperor Tiberius. He's reprimanded by Tiberius after he allowed Roman soldiers to carry shields into the Jerusalem, bearing the name and image of the Emperor Tiberius. So at least the account I was reading was, I think the soldiers had some big victory somewhere, Syria or something like that, and they came through Jerusalem in celebration. As they came through, they were carrying their banners and carrying their shields. And those standards, those banners representing their army, their troop, and their shields had images of Tiberius Caesar, and the Jews go crazy. You shall not have a graven image for yourself. And so it's an offense to the Jewish population. And Pilate allows it. He allows his soldiers to celebrate this way. Then later on, he's wanting to honor Caesar Tiberius and builds this fortress up in Caesarea, which is in northern Galilee. And at this fortress, I don't know if he built it or not, but at this fortress, he hangs these shields around the fortress. Who's going to care? It's in Galilee, out in the sticks. Puts these shields with the emperor's image, and guess who shows up? The Jews. And they're not happy about it. And they're snitches. Somehow this information all gets back to Tiberius. Possibly through Herod, you think, maybe? I don't know. So it gets back, and so Tiberius is angry. You would think Tiberius is like, well, yeah, you keep putting my image out there. But Tiberius, as a Caesar, knows you're not going to rule these people if you keep having these mobs and having to violently put these mobs down or stop them from protesting or whatever. And then the one that really got him in trouble was he used funds from the temple treasury. This is recorded by Josephus, a Jewish historian. He used funds from the temple treasury to build an aqueduct. What's an aqueduct?
Water.
Yeah, to bring water out of Jerusalem into another area, or into Jerusalem, I guess. When protesters amassed, Pilate had his soldiers beat many of them to death. So let me just play this game a little bit. How would he get money from the temple treasury?
Judas.
Chief priest.
Didn't think about Judas. I don't think that's the right answer, but that's creative. But how else would he get money from the temple treasury? He didn't steal it.
High priest.
The people who have the money bags, remember how I said there's kind of a quid pro quo? Twice I said it right. Going on here. You scratch my back, we'll scratch your back. You need water in Jerusalem, we have some money, so let's give you a little bit of money, and then you're going to owe us one. There's no other way for him to get money from the temple. Somebody had to give it to him, and the only people who could do that would be the chief priests. And so when he goes and uses his money to build the aqueduct, and the Jews get all excited about it, where are the chief priests? Well, how did he get the money? And they kind of turn on him, and now he's got this crowd of people angry, but he's smart. He's hid soldiers in the crowd wearing regular civilian clothes. And when the Jews go crazy, upset, they start beating. They take off there and they show the Roman soldiers and they beat them to death. This all gets back to Tiberius. So he was removed by Tiberius in 36, so 3 years after Jesus' death. After slaughtering Samaritans in Galilee, whom Pilate was absolutely certain were zealots who were armed, getting ready to try to attack Jerusalem. So he kills a whole bunch of Samaritans, and Tiberius says, we're done. And so we don't exactly know what happened after that. This is kind of recorded in Josephus. We don't exactly know what happened to Pilate after that. But many scholars say he died a normal death. The thought was, if you're familiar with Paul Meyer, who wrote this book, Paul Meyer is a Lutheran scholar, teaches in Ann Arbor, he's retired now, or Kalamazoo. Where's Kalamazoo? Is that Michigan State?
Michigan.
Is it Michigan? Or it's
Ann Arbor's Michigan
Western
State.
Western
Michigan.
His school is Western Michigan, where he taught.
Thank you. Thank you. I don't care what Kalamazoo is. He was at Western Michigan. We have it on authority. She was one of his students. No? Try it. Anyway, this is a great book. And when I was looking at a lot of research on Pontius Pilate for this presentation, Paul Myers quoted quite a bit, and not even in non-Lutheran circles. He's done his work. And so Paul, we're like this, you know. Dr. Meyer basically suggested that when Pontius Pilate was recalled to Rome, the thought process was Tiberius was going to have him put to death. That was the penalty for being a terrible governor. But in the process, Tiberius died. And so it was common in Roman government when a new emperor took place, a lot of slates were wiped clean, or maybe they just forgot about this lowly prefect from Jerusalem. And so he kind of had a new lease on life, but they think he kind of was exiled and he just died an old man. That's what a lot of people think. Now this trial with Jesus, of course, would change his life. So much so that he's been dead and gone. Pilate's been dead and gone for 2,000 years, and yet his name is spoken every single Sunday in our church. Every Sunday we say his name. We only say two names in our Apostles' Creed, and what are they?
Father.
Maybe my questions are too vague. Two human names are spoken in our Apostles' Creed.
Mary.
I just gave you the other one. Pontius Pilate. Okay, are we on the same page now?
Yes.
Okay. You couldn't get two opposite extremes here. Mary, the mother of the Lord, and Pontius Pilate, the one who killed the Lord, or had him sentenced to death. And yet we say his name. And it's not because we're honoring him or we're proud of him. What we're saying is, this is a historical fact. When Pontius Pilate was governor, Jesus suffered under him and was crucified and died. That's why we say that. And in John's Gospel, Pilate basically says this, I find no basis for a charge against him, and yet still handed him over to be crucified. Luke's Gospel is much more precise on this. Three times Pilate tried to let Jesus go. Three times he said this. I'm going to show you just a real quick clip of a video, and then we'll be done. How many of you have seen the Passion of the Christ movie? That movie is already 12 years old. Really? There's a clip here, if you remember this. I really appreciate in the movie how they show the struggle of Pontius Pilate. I mean, we're not supposed to obviously honor him, but I think we can kind of understand a little bit where his struggle was. He still made the wrong choice, but the right choice according to God's plan. So this is a clip. He's talking here with his wife. We don't know her name. Her name is not given in the scripture. She's only mentioned one time his wife is only mentioned one time, and that's the gospel. And she sends word to Pilate, don't have anything to do with this Jesus because I've been tormented in a dream about him. That's all we hear. But there's a lot of records that loosely think that her name was Claudia Procula. So in this movie, this clip, this is kind of the scene between Pilate and Claudia.
Quides peritas, Claudia? E amaldis? Em conheces quando de ti?
Ida, Áudia. Nome de tu?
Romulo. Podes me dizer?
Se não vis veritate maldire, nemo tibi dicere.
Vis meam veritatem conoscere, Claudia. Leveriones oprimebam in extazione remota undicim annos. Si hub non condemnado, ciu gaia fam sedicionem iniziaturum esse. Si ita condemnabo, discipuli eius iniziabunt, uter libet sanguis refunditur. Cesar men momit, Claudia. Bis momit. Vice proxima. Ipse iuravit sanguis erit meus, eces mea veritas.
All right. Totally short. So just this dramatic scene where we kind of get, if it's accurate, you know, we kind of get this, his world is pretty simple in that sense. If I set this man free, then these religious leaders will start another uprising, another revolt, and the last time that happened, I had to kill them, some of them, and Caesar's already told me not to do this anymore. If I don't, if I sent them to crucify, and all these thousands of people have come in for Jewish, you know, Passover that were, you know, Hosanna, Hosanna, those people will revolt, you know, and I gotta, you know, so he's, that's, I'm trying to gain some sympathy for him. I don't know if it's working or not. But just, we just kind of keep that in mind. And this is all, and I will say it this way, God is always at work. And he's even at work in our governments, in our leaders, even if they're not doing the right thing according to his law, he still uses that, can use that for his good purposes. And here you have Pontius Pilate, who God used for a great purpose, right? So let's pray. Heavenly Father, we know that you are always at work. There is nothing beyond your sight, your wisdom, and you use all things to accomplish your good purposes, and sometimes you don't recognize those good purposes or know what they are, but you do know, O Lord, and as we think about this account revealed to us by John, your apostle, and we see how you are working things out through the religious leaders, through the Roman government, everything was orchestrated to lead to this moment where Jesus would go to the cross for our sins, for the entire world, and to offer up his life, and to give us that salvation through his death and resurrection. And you would have all people to know that truth. And so you are still at work in infallible people, including us, including governments and authorities and teachers and religious leaders. You're still at work for that word of truth to be proclaimed, that others might hear and believe. So Lord, help us to be diligent in sharing your good word and to rejoice that in these scriptures you have made us wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.